All right, good evening, everybody, and welcome to tonight's Select Board meeting. We'll get started. So we have the consent agenda tonight. So we have warrants AP 1636 and PR 1636. One-day alcohol license for the top of the campus for April 9th. Committee resignation from the Treasurer slash Collector Advisory Committee, Joan Zuzgo. And then we have a Chapter 90 reimbursement request.
Except for Chapter 90.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so...
Did we get a resignation notice from Joan as to why she was getting done on the committee?
I spoke briefly to Linda about this, and it just seems that she has a time, she's concerned about the time commitment.
Understand. Great.
Okay, so 7 o'clock, we'll have some public comment. Is anyone here that would like to address the board? Richard.
Is he ready?
Are you
ready? You're on.
Ready? Okay, first of all, I'd like to make amends for my excitement last week while I was trying to be placed on the agenda. Okay. I have just too much respect to create a problem being the selectman in the past, you know. But the material I was asking for really excites me, and I have a hard time controlling myself. I'm asking once again to be placed on the agenda. This is the second time I've been asking, so hopefully I'll be placed on the agenda to speak about financial issues, okay? My questions are, why did the four members resign on the Finance Committee? I would like to know that. I think I know the answer, but I think the general public would like to know it also. Collectively, these four people that resigned had over 40 years of experience in financial matters for this town. That's such a loss to this town, it's indescribable. Second thing is, the question is, I want to know why the tri-board hasn't met in almost a year. For the people that don't know what the tri-board is, the tri-board consists of the Board of Selectmen, the Assessors, and the Finance Committee. And it was created for a job to keep abreast of the figures in the budget, how they were going throughout the year, to stay on top of it. I have been crunching the numbers for the budget for 2016, and I hope my figures were wrong, that we're going to be in a deficit. I went to the assessor's office to concern myself to make sure my figures were wrong or correct. Sadly to say, my figures were correct, and they were much less than what the assessor's office has. The assessor's office is projecting a deficit in the fiscal 2016 budget of approximately $700,000 by fall. And as an extra Christmas present for the townspeople of Hadley, he told me it could go to $1 million. We've taken $504,000 out of free cash last year to balance the budget, which left it at $2.39 or something like that. So we have no free cash to take to balance or clear up this deficit. Secondly, maybe we'll build up the free cash again to $300,000 by the end of the fiscal year, hopefully. But that still leaves us with approximately $700,000 that we have to come up with from somewhere, or take it from our rainy day fund, the stabilization fund. We have to begin discussion on this immediately to find out what is happening. I'm surprised the assessors haven't been brought in to inform you earlier, that they would have came in on their own volition. But discussion has to start on this immediately and begin to eradicate the problem. Thank you.
So, are you free Friday?
I don't know.
Around lunchtime?
No, because okay. I'm working. We got half days this week.
Half days? We're gonna set the agenda then, so I was just wondering if you might wanna come in and make sure you get the agenda items right, so that was all.
All I request is just to be on it.
Okay.
Very simple.
Any other public comment from the audience? No? Okay. So we're a little ahead of schedule. So we will jump down to the RFQs and RFPs we have on our agenda. So Mr. Nixon?
So we have three to consider tonight. The first was a request for qualifications for an owner's project manager. This is received comments from the Municipal Building Committee. I made the incorporated the comments that were submitted and resubmitted it back to the Municipal Building Committee. I heard today that they accept the revisions that I've made. So this RFP is now ready to release. We'll obviously have to raise funding for this at the annual town meeting. I've talked to our chief financial advisor about the strategy for going forward with the funding, and I think we have a way to move forward. So my recommendation, based upon feedback from the Municipal Building Committee, is that we release the request for qualifications for an owner's project manager.
So moved.
Second.
Any more discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 The second is a request for proposals for land in the center of Hadley. I've written this up as a traditional request for proposals with evaluation criteria so that we can identify the most advantageous site, and then after we have ranked our selection for advantageous sites, we'd open up the price proposals and be able to make that match between quality and the best price for the taxpayers. Again, this is something that we would have to raise money for at the annual town meeting. Your chief financial advisor was in front of you last week to talk about the timing and the terms of borrowing for this, but this has now been reviewed by our chief financial advisor as well as the Municipal Building Committee, and we're ready to move forward with this RFP.
Any discussion?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The third one is the request for proposals for the sale of North Hadley Village Hall. This RFP has already been issued. The Municipal Building Committee came back with suggested changes, and so I've prepared an addendum for this RFP. That addendum incorporates as many of the suggestions from the Municipal Building Committee as I could fit in. And I also pushed back the date until April 4th at 2 p.m. for a deadline for this. Municipal Building Committee reviewed this information last night and received word today that they approve of the changes that were made. So this addendum is now ready to be released.
And we're going to release that to the three people who showed interest in purchasing the property?
Absolutely. And I've already been in contact with one of them.
So moved.
Second.
Any more discussion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So before we move to the next item, so we just put two RFPs and an RFQ out. So we need to be thinking, and we probably, maybe not the next meeting, we'll probably take it up at a meeting later in March. We need to decide what we want to do for how to review this. Actually, we probably need to get a little sooner than that. So do we as a select board want to be the review committee for these RFP and the RFQs? Do we want to appoint another committee? Do we want to appoint a building committee to do the RFQ? So those are kind of the options we have. And we need to kind of decide, and then to actually, we'll have to do, probably do it next meeting. Mm-hmm. So if we have the first one coming back in April. So we need to make that decision, and then we have to solicit people to join the committee. I mean, the North Hadley Hall one, we might want to ask the Historic Commission if they want to have a person on it. Mm-hmm. Wait a minute, I should move back before I say that. We wanted to have a member of the one or two members of the current building committee on that one, and then maybe a select board member or something like that. So we have three little review committees we have to come up with. So as you are out and about and you talk to people, if people talk to you, we need to kind of firm up probably by next Wednesday how we want to do this. And then if we do do a building committee for the RFQ type review, normally those building committees stay with that project. So that would be a building committee that would stay through the whole project, which may be short. Town meeting may end it really quickly. Town meeting may say go, and then it would be a longer duration. So it's something truly to think about as people are listening to this discussion and thinking about it. Those are big things.
Well, they're relative. These are three of the relatively smaller projects.
The
sale, the purchase, and the RFQ.
The sale and the purchase are relatively small.
Right.
The RFQ could be the whole duration of the building cycle.
Why would we vary from the building committee that we already have?
Because we might want to take the building committee we already have and keep them focused on the projects they're working on, the smaller projects, mm-hmm. and then have another building committee which is more focused on the buildings that we need to replace. So the buildings we want to replace, we might want to have someone from the senior center on that committee. There's no one on the building committee from the senior center. We might want to have someone from Park and Rec. We do have someone from Park and Rec on the building committee. Mm-hmm. So we might want to focus that group more on the buildings we're attempting to build and the services we're attempting to provide, not so much on the nuts and bolts of how to maintain the buildings. So those are things for us to think about and think over as we, because actually we'll put it on the agenda for next Wednesday.
And I think we also need to be conscious of just quite frankly burnout too. I mean, this municipal building committee, God bless them, has been working very, very hard for a very long time.
Yes.
So I don't want to layer anything over. I agree with you, figuring out what's the best use of those resources and what they're willing to do.
What was the task at hand for them?
For the building committee?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't maintenance oriented, wasn't it?
No, their main task was to review all the buildings and come back to us with recommendations and an action plan. And they did that, and they've actually executed a lot of the action plan. So we've gotten more than we asked for from them.
Yeah.
I kind of agree with Jerry. I mean, if they're interested in it, then I don't see any reason why two members of the board here can't go along with the building committee and keep on going with it.
Yeah, but
they're so involved in it right now.
I agree with that, but you do have to involve the other participants. I mean, senior center, Park and Rec, and you might want to have more of the elected officials or the members of the what's the senior?
Susan?
Housing.
No.
Council on Aging.
I always say that wrong and get yelled
at. Well, we also have an issue, a practical issue, and Tim Neihardt agreed last time. I mean, we have sitting inspectors that can't reasonably be involved with the construction that they're then going to turn around and inspect on behalf of the town.
Correct.
So we knew at some point we were going to have to make that shift anyway.
So that's our homework. So our RFQs and RFP and RFQ is on the street, and we just as a select board need to decide how we're going to frame the review of this.
Mm-hmm.
So if anybody is out there and wants to talk to us about it, please feel free. We'll probably
I don't think the issue of what to do with the old library building has come to light either. It's another building that they think we're going to have to take care of, and I'm really not in favor of that.
Yes. I mean, eventually when we do this, if we actually go forward what we're saying and build a new library, build a new senior center, build a new building,
every other town that you go to, Salisbury put up a brand new library and they bulldozed down the old one. And as many other schools, South Hadley built a new school, they bulldozed down the other one. I mean, to make room for parking and other things that is desperately needed over there. If they have any intentions of using the senior center and taking that down, there certainly needs to be more parking space.
I think you just woke up a few historic preservationists in town, Joyce.
Probably. That's what I usually do.
So maybe they'll be happy to join.
No, they're really going to want to be a big committee.
Okay, so that's really not...
Could I just make a comment on that? It probably behoove you to ask the building committee to see if they even want to take on that task. They may tell you no, and then you know you have to appoint a committee.
So, I think we've already been having some discussions.
Yes. Yeah. All right, so saying that, mm-hmm. that took us right to our first appointment. It's 7:15.
All right.
Yay. So we have our schools here.
Yes. Welcome. Here is the PowerPoint. Thank you so much. So I'll do that here, and I'll do some out of here. Pass the rest along. All right. So.
Well, I'll need the PowerPoint because I certainly can't read that.
Let's not have my reading. Well, we will do our best.
Endeavor, I understand. I may be able to read it on the screen. Can you read that?
Thank you very much for inviting us here this evening to present the school department's fiscal year 17 budget to the select board. I'm Annie McKenzie, the superintendent of schools, Linda Dunleavy, the chair, Rohi Grant, school committee member, Vista Chardon, our business manager. And I want to start off by saying thank you, and I really want to be clear that I do not envy your task. And I say that because I've had the pleasure of attending the department head meetings, and I'm really impressed with the quality of the department heads you have in this town. They're thoughtful people who put a lot of thought into designing their budgets and putting their requests before you. And I know that they presented to you compelling narratives about what they need, and they've given you data on what they need, and you have the unenviable task of listening to all of our requests and then trying to reconcile that with the fiscal realities in town. So I don't envy it, and thank you for giving us this time. And I also want to say I'm here to advocate primarily for the children who are enrolled in Hadley Public Schools and for their parents, but also the school department is committed to collaborating with the town and coordinating with all the departments to see how we can develop a budget that ensures maximum benefit to as many departments as possible and improves the lives of residents in Hadley. Our school department budget, we're going to start with a slide. I'm not quite sure how we have to do this.
Yeah, it's a little tricky. It's the strategy slide that's up.
Well, I was not seeing it there, that's why. So if we just go to the slides, that would be helpful. And you can just stay on the slide, that'd be great. In short, the school committee and the district leadership team of the school district came together and created the district strategy. And I think that's important for you to know. We have a strategy document that drives our decision making and our resource allocation. The school committee evaluates their progress toward meeting their objectives and goals every single month because we want to make sure that we're getting a good return on investment. In other words, if we're investing resources and money in a program or an initiative or a service, we want to evaluate the extent to which that investment is moving us closer to meeting our strategic objectives. You heard me share at the capital meeting, when we all shared our capital plans, that we are certainly seeing some good progress in the school department, and progress that was underway before I got here. But we have some great data that we've seen this year. Some of it I've shared with you, I'll share again for the public. We saw at Hadley Elementary School, the way that the state evaluates schools is through something called a Progress and Performance Index. All students in Hadley Elementary, that metric is a score from 0 to 100. Between 2014 and 2015, all students in Hadley Elementary improved their Progress Performance Index, their PPI score, by an increase of 30 points. Students considered high needs in that group increased by 50 points in a single year. We have our English language learners who are also assessed on statewide standardized testing. About 85% of those who were assessed achieved at very high or high growth. And that's really phenomenal because statewide, less than 20% of students hit very high or high growth targets. At Hopkins Academy, you've heard me share some of our data around our post-secondary outcomes. 3 out of 4 kids who graduate from Hopkins will obtain a college degree within 4 years, which is certainly beats the 1 out of 2 or 50% average statewide. Our students complete advanced placement courses successfully at a much higher rate than we see across the state, and our statewide standardized test scores are high. In addition to that, we've invested in early literacy interventions, and we've seen pretty incredible results. The school committee has been looking at that data since last year. And we also have invested in a positive behavioral intervention and support system to support kids emotionally. And we've seen some wonderful gains in social emotional development. So I say all of that because our budget should really, all it is a quantitative way of describing our resource allocation strategy. And we owe it to taxpayers to say, here's what we're investing, here's how we invest it, and as a result, this is what's happening. That's just a snapshot of what's happening, and that strategy document that Richard showed a moment ago sums up where we're trying to get to. The next slide, I'm not sure if someone can touch a button, and we can go to that, shows, so all of that to say, and we showed you a slide similar to this last year, that we're headed in the right direction with school choice. The school choice market is really competitive in Western Massachusetts. One of my superintendent colleagues describes this area as choice on steroids. There are a lot of choices. And you can see that students choicing in at 97 and students choicing out at 48, and that is dipped down from 62 in a previous year. The next slide shows you our staffing allocation, and this is just backdrop to the budget request. So what's driving the budget? In fiscal year 17, there are no increases. The stacked bars at the top, it shows teachers. In fiscal year 16, there were 60 FTE, means full-time equivalent. In fiscal year 17, the same amount. Paraprofessionals, 25 in fiscal year 17. Other, 21. So there are no staffing changes. There was a slight staffing increase between fiscal year 15 and 16. We developed a program at the elementary school. I'll talk a little bit more about that when we get to the slide on out-of-district tuitions and vocational tuitions. The next slide is a slide to give you some context, because it's understandable that folks would ask, if it's a level services budget, so we were directed by the town to put together a level services budget, which is what we did, and it's understandable that folks would say, how can a level services budget increase if essentially the services are the same? Well, in order to meet the needs of all of our students well, we have to ensure that we provide educational programs that are well suited to the students whom we are serving. And Hadley is no different than what we're seeing nationally. And nationally, we've seen an increase in students who have very specific needs, particularly students who have autism spectrum disorders. And I want to be really clear, we don't present this as a problem. It's wonderful. Our students are wonderful, every student whom we have in our schools, and they all bring amazing gifts and talents to our public school district. But some students require much more intensive support in order to be successful in public education. And this slide just shows you that across the country, students being diagnosed with autism spectrum disorders has gone from a 1 in 150 ratio to a 1 in 68. It's the fastest growing disability category in public education. In Hadley Public Schools, students with autism have more than tripled since 2005. And meeting the needs of students, again, requires specialized services and supports. And there are financial implications to that. But let me underscore, rather than thinking of it as an expense to be managed, I believe it is an investment to be made, because they bring so much to our schools. Some people might wonder, the next slide is a slide that we're very grateful. The South Adelaide, the Special Education Parent Advisory Council for Hadley presented to the school committee at their last meeting. And this is a slide from their presentation. They asked parents questions about their perceptions of whether or not their students' needs were being met. And they also looked at data about Hadley Public Schools as compared to other districts. What this slide shows, and it's very hard for the public to see, but that even though we're keeping up to, we're working hard to keep up, we're working hard to keep up to meet the needs of all students, we still, compared to other districts in Hampshire County and in Southern Berkshire County, our ratio of students with special needs to special education professional staff is very high. So for every single special education professional staff that works within special education, for every one, the ratio is 20 students. Now that's the highest in this, or 21, excuse me, 1 to 21. The next highest is 1 to 16. And some of them are as low as 1 to 10 or 1 to 11. So we certainly are, in some cases, we're more than double or almost double in that ratio of students to staff. So although we're working hard to meet the needs of all students, we're not being frivolous in our staffing patterns by any stretch of the imagination. And I want to again thank the CPAC for providing us that presentation.
Just a quick question on that. Can you define staff? Is that sped dedicated teachers as well as paralegals, or paralegals, paraprofessionals, right?
No, in this case, we're talking, it would not be our education support personnel or paraprofessionals, but it would be teachers and related services, school psychologists, occupational therapy, physical therapy, and they derive that data from the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education website. That statistic isn't there specifically, but they looked at two factors and pulled the data together. So this is from the presentation. And our next slide, to the wrong place. So our next slide, again, what that shows us is increasing costs. Almost like we project to spend probably an additional $250,000 next year in vocational tuitions, so students who elect to go to vocational schools, and students who will be going into, who need to be in out-of-district placements, so we don't have programming to meet their needs in the district. And as you can see, about three additional students are interested in vocational education than we had from last year, so it's roughly a $60,000 increase, and that's a conservative estimate there. And in special education, we have a significant increase. Students who require a placement out of our district. I want the select board and the public to know, and it goes with our previous slides, we are committed to doing everything we possibly can to educate students within our district and to create programs to make sure we keep students in our district. We have a legal obligation, I say we have a moral obligation, not because of what we, not only what we owe those students, but because of what they bring to our schools. Last year, the school committee approved the development of a specialized program at the elementary school. And that program, we project in FY17, the cost avoidance of that program. So in other words, if these students were in out-of-district placements, we can project what those tuitions would most likely be, and the cost of transportation. And we estimate in fiscal year 17 that the savings, the cost avoidance, right, so it's not savings like we got it back, we're just avoiding a cost, would be between $150,000 to $230,000. And that range is because on the very conservative end, the transportation costs assume that you're just getting surcharged to add a child to an existing route, that you don't have to pay a cost per day per bus to put a child on a brand new bus or a new route. So we are committed to educating children in our district. We want our students to stay with us, and we are committed to being not only keeping students in the district, but to being fiscally responsible. The other thing we're a bit up against on our next slide are grant funds. What we see in grant funding, again, very hard to read, but at the top, so in what essentially are entitlement grants, grants where we are just given, this is what you get. This is the money you're getting from the state. That money has decreased significantly, especially since in years prior, fiscal year 10, fiscal year 11, fiscal year 12, we had the American Reinvestment and Recovery Act, what was called ARRA funds, and then we had Race to the Top, RTT funds. They're all gone. So all that's gone. Thankfully, our competitive grant funds have gone up a bit. Renee Denenfield, our nurse leader, has done a great job of increasing some of those funds, but those are really dedicated to mental health support programs for students and health and wellness programs for students. And now I'm going to turn it over to Chris to show you the, talk to you about the macro and micro overviews of the budget.
Okay, so the micro overview breaks down the budget into, well, it looks like about 10 or 12 different categories. And just shows really the breakdown, the percentage of the total budget that each of these categories make up. You can see a couple of, like administration, 5% of the total budget. Some of these items, such as, say, maintenance, is maintenance even in this one? Yes, maintenance, 7%.
7%, yeah.
That does not include their salary. I mean, I'm sorry, it does include their salary on this slide. The next slide, it does not. And it really is just kind of an informational piece that shows you, you know, where the money is going within the budget. The next slide actually breaks it down has a macro overview, and that breaks
Chris,
down.
What's the average Smith School student fee right now?
So our tuition right now is just shy of $19,000 in fiscal year 16, and that is, there are additional charges depending on a child's educational needs. So there are additional charges if a child needs additional educational supports. But if a child just general ed and general education and vocational, just shy of 19 this year. Is
that's
correct,
yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the FY17 numbers are not out yet. They usually come about a week.
But the last 3 years, it's gone up quite substantially, hasn't it?
A lot.
Two years ago.
Yeah, that's where I said the three students at 60,000 is a conservative estimate.
That's taxation without representation. We have zero input to any of the costs regarding Smith. It's everybody.
Yeah. Right. But Northampton.
Is Franklin County similar to that? Or?
No. Smith Oak is the only vocational school in Massachusetts like it.
So we're broken down a little less finely in this slide. What it does show, however, is about 66% of the budget is made up of salaries. So you know, as you look at this slide, you can kind of see what accounts for some of the increases in the budget, because the salary line obviously has contractual increases that are built into the budget. So again, as some of the tuition costs increase from year to year, so do the salary costs, even though the number of employees stay the same. You can see that's the vast majority of the budget. Other things like the supplies and materials, that's a relatively small portion of the budget. We do what we can when it comes to saving money, getting the best pricing we can on supplies. It's only 2.4% of the total budget, so it is a very small item. It's the salaries that really drive it. And in this particular slide, again, like I started to say on the one before, maintenance, utilities, special ed, vocational tuition, other, none of those include the salaries because they're just included in the salary line. So for maintenance and utilities, that would be the fuel oil, repair of buildings, that kind of thing. Reserve fund projections, that's basically the school choice in money that we have in our account. You can see where we started at the beginning of this fiscal year, about 656,000. We're looking to get about 545,000 in. We're projected to use 523 of that, so we'll finish the year slightly above where we started at the beginning of the year. Then as we go through FY17, we're looking to see that amount decrease a little bit, down to 500,000 coming in. We're using 525,000 in the budget, so it actually brings the figure down about, say, $25,000 from where we ended FY16, and keeps it pretty close, but about $3,000 less than where we were at the beginning of this fiscal year.
Chris, can I just ask, so we were going from 99 to 97 incoming students?
Yes.
Right, and so just those two drops it that much?
No, actually, I mean, the school choice money coming in, it's a lot of it is a timing issue where we get it. It just dropped down starting with our December payment. And so what I did was I annualized that December payment and assumed that that much would be continuing throughout FY17. You know, again, it could go slightly up or down. I don't see it substantially changing, but if we're lucky, it would.
So, she's all done. Your 545 for 16, you just received two something, I see in the paper, right? That was just approved?
We what?
200 and something that the state approved of that distribution funds? Or was that school choice?
I don't know either. That would be wonderful news. Yes. This could be the finest meeting that
I've
in a while.
I happened to see it in the paper, I think last week.
It's in the paper. It must be true.
Is that 545 part of school choice?
The 545 is the school choice money, yes. Okay. We get basically a payment every month for that.
Okay.
John, are you talking about the increase in Chapter 70? Hasn't there been a proposed increase in Chapter 70 money?
Is that what, maybe that's what it was?
I think that's what it is, and that actually, that doesn't flow through there, that flows right into the general fund.
Which would be good news, too.
Exactly.
It was approved, I know it was approved.
Now if we see it.
I do think I should mention with this particular fund of money that it's the type of account that, you know, you see the beginning balance of $656,000 and the amount that we're expecting to take in throughout the year. What we take out of this account actually comes in June. So, you know, what we hear a lot is that this balance is building and building all year long, and that, well, you're sitting on $1 million, when in reality, we know that $500,000 is coming out of it, whether we take it in June or September. At the beginning of the school year, either way, it's going to be taken out. So I just wanted to make sure that you were aware that even though there may be $1 million sitting in the account
money.
Right now,
it's spent.
It's already earmarked.
It flows.
Yeah.
Right. Is it, Marcia?
Yes, it is.
So
if we go with the level services budget, and if you go with the local contribution that comes out with, we end perhaps with about a $650,000 in reserve. We've talked to you about this several times. It's our goal to maintain a fairly healthy balance in the reserve account so that we can cover unexpected expenses, and we would so that we don't have to come to the town. So we've had examples of that in FY15. You can remember that we decided to open that substantially separate classroom with FY15 school choice funds. In FY16, we've had some maintenance and some special ed costs that we did not anticipate, even since starting this budget. In the January school committee meeting, I asked our special ed assistant superintendent if the SPED numbers seemed reasonable. She said yes. The next day, we got a call that we had another out-of-district placement. We had a meeting last Monday. We said this is a good budget. The next week, we got $60,000 more of Smith Voc. So just like your budget evolves, our budget evolves, which is why we want to keep a balance in the school choice account so that we can take care of that. That said, here's where we are with the budget. The administration came to us originally with a budget that included some modest increases, I think about 1.5 staff and some other support needs. That was coming up with a 7.94% increase in the budget. We did not develop a budget with those requests honored and instead did a level services budget, but as you saw from our charts, level services budget with contractual obligations, with SPED costs, with Smith Voc costs, and with our assumptions, with the assumptions that we've made about other use of other funds, we are coming in at a 6.68% increase for our level services total budget, 6.68% increase.
What does that mean in numbers? I see what it means in a percentage. What's the number?
Because it's impossible for you to read. 7890149. That's total.
Is that what you mean, or from last
increase,
year?
Increase, yeah.
What?
We're up how much from last year?
Well, it was
332,000. Is that right?
Right. We're talking total versus you might be talking local contribution.
Yeah.
So right now we're talking
Total budget right now.
Right. And
okay.
I want to say it's 703,000.
That sounds pretty close to it. Yeah.
$703,000 is up. It's up $703,000. Is that what you said, Chris?
No. She was saying 7030 was the budget amount.
Yeah.
I'm looking it up.
All right. Thanks.
From last year's presentation.
So I ran some of the calculations. So when I'm ready to talk about the local contribution, I can run those numbers right now.
Linda's finished.
I understand. I'm just letting people know that I've got this information.
Roughly. Total budget right now is $7,890,149. That's our total level services budget. We would use $83,000 from the preschool revolving account to cover some of our operating expenses. We are proposing, if
Our first proposal is to use $525,000 of school choice money. That about matches what we expect to bring in. That is always our goal, is that we are using about the amount that's coming in. With grants, we are realistically expecting another $386,000. That leaves a total local contribution, so not total school budget, but a total local contribution of $6,895,099. That's a 6.6% increase, and we heard you loud and clear last year that you asked us to not come in with 6 or 7% increases. We then calculated, it was our memory that revenue growth in the town was about 4.4%, so we did the calculation of what additional cuts or use of school choice would have to be made to get to that 4.4% local contribution, and that would be either using school choice or cutting $143,000, and that moves the budget to a growth, the local contribution to a growth that matches revenue growth. So our summary of this is our budget is primarily personnel. We have shown you that our SPED costs are increasing, and this is not unique to Hadley, it's a national trend. That cuts to the budget in all likelihood will impact the level of service to our children and make the Hadley Public School System less appealing as a choice in community, which only then worsens the school budget and town budget condition. So we could bring our FY17 ask of you down to match municipal growth. We likely in FY17 would do a combination of cuts and using more school choice funds. But I guess the bottom line for us, and we've talked to you about this for several years, without a significant new source of town revenue in some way, or dramatic changes to how we provide education in the Hadley Public Schools, or a combination of both, we do not have a situation that is sustainable.
And if I can just jump in, it's a $494,000 increase from last year.
Thank you, Chris.
Total operating or local contribution?
Total
operating, not local contribution.
So the local contribution increase would be $279,571, based upon the information that was presented here.
Is there?
Well, let's talk about it being non-sustainable. I mean, I hear you loud and clear. Loud and clear, and we hear it, you hear it, everybody hears it. What's the answer to this problem? Do you have any?
What's my answer?
No, I mean, there's not a, it's not a, yeah, what's your answer?
My answer is that we need more revenue in this town, and that we should be thinking about a 2.5 override that would fully fund this town in a healthy, vibrant, sustaining way. Every year we struggle to fund the schools, police, fire, everything, and our buildings are falling apart. We as a town, we need more revenues.
And would you do that as a matrix, or would you do it as a general override? Would you come up with a number from everybody that you talked about, whether it's buildings or fire or police and schools, and lump it into one sum and say this is what we need to do?
I think we are one town, and yes, that's what I would do.
No,
I don't, if you're asking would I do a separate school, that would not be my preference.
Okay.
Because I think the needs of the town are greater than just the school. I love the Arlington model. The Arlington model is that they do a five-year forecast of what their town needs, and they work with the people of the town to understand the five-year needs. They pass an override. They are whole for 5 years, and then they start again to figure out what they need. I understand a 2.5 override is controversial, but we've been at this many, many years, and every year it's a struggle, and I don't know how we continue on.
Could you talk about what other, to that point, I mean, could you talk about what other options could be explored as well? I mean, in the absence
yep.
of that, what are people's
what
choices?
What we talked about is that we could, us not bring in a whole lot of money, I don't remember what the amount is, we could charge for athletics. We could charge for activities. That's not going to bring in a lot of money.
It's not going to do that.
We are not.
That's a Band-Aid.
I'm giving you. I'm giving you from small to large.
Yeah.
We could charge for busing. We could stop busing for our Hopkins kids. That not only is not good for air quality, but again, is a larger Band-Aid, but still a Band-Aid.
Mm-hmm.
And then we could start to look at how we regionalize. There's advantages and disadvantages of regionalizing. A big disadvantage to the town is that when you go into a regional school district, the first towns that pass the budget control the budget. And it isn't a discussion back and forth. It's the regional school committee is coming to you with the budget and telling you what the budget's going to be. And so, it may be that that's where we have to go over the next several years, but
yes, one more question
a
on
town
that?
Decision on that.
On the Arlington model the idea of having a kind of a that one-time override and then all boats floating, so to speak, and then you're off and running. Have you run, not suggesting you should, I'm just asking. Have you actually run any numbers? Because one of the concerns was that with that is that when some of the drivers here to your cost increases are effectively uncontrollable,
mm-hmm.
The piece that's not in here is in the town side, which is also the whole charter reimbursement issue, which is on Capitol Hill. I mean, all of that stuff, the possibility of additional entrance for charter schools, taking the cap off. I think part of the concern would be, might that too become a Band-Aid, and within what time frame and under what scenarios? I mean, I think that would be a really important thing for people to consider.
I think with any long-term plan, you are forecasting to the best of your information and with the best investigation and research you can do, but it's still a forecast. And so that you hope that you are forecasting correctly, but we could never promise. Well, just
like we
no
couldn't
part
either. No.
of the mm-hmm. town mm-hmm. could forecast exactly.
So then the thing to remember about the Arlington model is that every 5 years there's a possibility of an override.
That's right.
So you model out 5 years, you prepare for the override, you sell the override, and then once you get where you're going, you're forecasting again for the next override. So that's the thing to remember about that, where they think ahead about what they need to spend and they keep adjusting as they go along. You just can't do it one time, which is what we're kind of sitting in now. We haven't done it, so we're sitting here. So
I think the thing that we remember, that I know it's budget time right now, but also on our plate is the buildings, and land purchases and of that nature, and everything. We're going to be asking the taxpayers to increase their taxes enormously with all these projects that are going on that people want us to take care of, but you can't take care of them with the budget that we have.
Which is why you present to them the options and let them decide.
Well, exactly.
Which
but,
ones
you know,
are most important
there is
prioritized.
No, there is no option when we're doing the budget. There's some options, I'm not saying that, but I'm saying that you have to be able to take care of what you have right now, and that's where we've gotten into such a rut, and everybody can come back at us, and they can go back 20 years and say, well, how come you didn't take care of the buildings? Well, the buildings didn't get taken care of because there was no money. And so that's always been the story here in Hadley. There's been no money for anything extra.
Yep.
And we have been able, I can honestly say, we have been able to take care of education, and we've always supported education for as long as I can remember. And I think that's always been the utmost. We've always been very proud of our school system. So the word regional doesn't really sit well with, you know, people that live here in town or move to this town with kids, because they come here for that purpose, the majority of them.
Yeah.
So.
And the cost savings, if I may.
The cost savings on regional models is inconclusive, so.
And you see them battling around us in all the school systems, and this one dropping out up in the hills, and, you know, I mean, so nothing is perfect.
I will say the governor seems to have, and the governor's office seems to have backed away from even really coming after this idea of regionalization in terms of towns, municipalities, or school districts, is encouraging shared services models, which we are actively pursuing even now with surrounding school districts. So I'm in conversations with a couple of different superintendents and identifying where we have openings that are similar and asking, and not just with surrounding superintendents, also I met with our charter school in town here. So we're keeping all options on the table to share services.
I think people think that it's a luxury to have sports or to have extracurricular activities, but I can tell you I was a staunch supporter of never charging for school activities or fees, because it's really a part of the total education process and of the child and what they get out of school and the reason for them to come to the school and learn. So, I mean, that's
not... And you don't want any kid to not be able to participate.
That's right.
And that's for financial reasons.
Right. Most systems that do charge fees have tiered schedules. The reality is our families who qualify for low income qualify as low income. Those percentages went up in 1 year from 17% to just shy of 25%. And that even on a tiered model, it can just be impossible. You know, it's still, people will opt out because they can't afford it.
John, the committee, the way it sits right now, Linda, with the charter school influx, are you seriously looking at a regionalization figure at some point?
It's just one of the options that's available.
I think it's one of the options that we have to consider. Truly, if we erode at our reserve fund significantly in FY17, then it's that much harder to get out of it in FY18, right? So that if we go $143,000 more into school choice in FY17, then to come whole again in FY18, the cost of level services increase plus that $143,000, so that it's a compounding problem. And so that if that happens, what we have is our cushion for reserves quickly is gone.
Dwindling.
And so that we, 3 or 4 years, probably.
Well, that's,
and so that we would have 3 or 4 years to.
So you got 3 or 4 years, the way the general budget's dwindling away. We're out of time now, you know.
I think the governor is playing a waiting game with this thing, with the school districts. I don't think you hear anything more about regionalization, because they know it's just a matter of time before small municipalities with small school systems are going to be so against the wall that they're going to have to do something, whether it's regionalization or what they have to do. But it's a waiting game now. They kind of presented it originally and backed right off. I don't know.
We've not studied the issue. We don't have figures.
Yeah.
There hasn't been. We have a commission to study.
Hold on. So the problem with regionalization, though, forced regionalization you're talking about, Jerry, is that, you know, who do we get forced into regionalized with? The community has got a $21 tax rate. The community has got a $17 tax rate. Or, I mean, that's really a problem, because it'd be a very interesting thing to see how you would force regionalization in the school and then pass that on to the communities. It's that would be very interesting. I do think that we're being kind of led down a path, and we're going to end up in this position where we have to do something drastic. But.
Can we just, one of the pieces of information that's not in here is the total enrollment. So when we're looking at the school choice in and out relative to what the enrollment has been, I know at some point, you know, it's widely publicized that there's a generally declining enrollment of the school-age population, and I don't know if you've projected out based on the birth rate in town, and it's not perfect, because you've got houses going up and all that stuff, and we don't know who moves in and who moves out, but I mean, that's certainly another factor. To the extent that the enrollment is showing a slow, long-term decline, then we're also looking at these dollars relative to the population that we're actually serving. So I'm just wondering if maybe we could
get that in here too.
Absolutely.
Although everyone in the area's got a declining school population.
Roby can probably speak to that. CES did a pretty exhaustive study of what's happening with enrollment in Hampshire County.
See, that's the thing, I mean, and school choice is really filling, for every kid that's not taking a seat that we have capacity for, we're doing everything in our power to fill it, it appears, right? But at some point, you know, it's a supply and demand, yeah.
Precisely.
Is that because of the population's going down, or is it because of the charter schools or?
It's population decline.
Population.
Franklin County, Hampshire County, all of them. So but the competition for students gets fiercer between districts. It's not a pleasant situation.
Doesn't make any sense, really.
There are districts out east who agree they won't participate in school choice. So they don't. It's not the case out here, because we have districts out here that if they did not have school choice students, they would fold. They'd be done next year. They're that dependent on school choice.
We were one of the last to join it.
Yeah. Take $500,000 out of our budget.
So, any other comments, questions from the select board?
Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation.
So I'd like to, before you go, I think there's some questions and comments from the audience. Does anybody in the audience like to ask?
Just after listening to the discussion, a quick couple of comments. Part of their budget is contingent on grants. Selectman Chungalo can attest to this when she was chairman of the school committee. They drove 90 miles to Boston, elated. They're going to be awarded a renovation for the high school, just about $3 million. When they get to Boston, they tell them, oh, everything's been changed. This is going to become a core project. You're losing $2 million. So they just had a minimal reconstruction and not full construction, you know. So.
Can I just, I can't read the number, but I think it's, we are only assuming 67,000 of discretionary grants. The rest are entitlement grants that we get.
That are guaranteed. That's good. That's a positive. The other thing is, I watched your meeting the other night, and I noticed you're beginning to protect your school choice money. You voted to send the ball fields to capital planning instead of taking any funding out of your school choice. So that's a beginning of protecting your money and sending things to school, to the town, to begin to handle the problems. The last thing, it was kind of interesting about regionalization. Most folks probably don't even remember this, but 25 years ago, Hatfield needed a brand new school, and they came to Hadley, and they said, would you be interested in regionalizing with us? Let's take a vote. We took a vote. Hatfield voted no. Hadley voted yes. So there is concerned people here in this community that probably would consider regionalization if it would benefit the students in Hadley.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions from the audience? All right. Thank you very much. You've given us a lot to think about.
Thanks.
Thank you for coming in.
Jerry, you want a bigger copy?
As long as I had a magnifying glass, I'll be fine.
I'm right there with you.
Well, thank you.
All right.
Next
so.
Next time with credits.
This is what.
So our next item is we have an appointment with the Lake Warner Dam. No. Yes, we do.
Yeah, we do.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
I'm a little, I'm 15 minutes off. So, go ahead, come on up.
Hi, I'm Kristen Ward. I'm the executive director of Kestrel Land Trust and acting on behalf of the Lake Warner LLC, which is working with Morris Root here, our engineer, to facilitate the repair of the Lake Warner Dam. I think most all of you are aware of this project. It's been supported by town meeting through CPA funds, and we now have assurances from the state that the funding is ready. We're preparing to begin construction between July 1st and September 30th. We're going through the permitting process with the Hadley Concom. I met with David Nixon a couple weeks ago, and he suggested that we come in tonight to clarify the process and talk about the funding piece of it. So I guess I turn it over to you to explain how that works.
Sure. Last week, if you recall, I raised the policy issue of how to handle the public money with respect to both the procurement and the contract management. I talked to Mr. Morris Root, who's going to be in charge of the technical side of the project. He and I had a long conversation about procurement requirements as well as contract management requirements. He was able to satisfy me that he understands completely the procurement laws of the Commonwealth. And so my concerns have been addressed. I think that they can handle this in a responsible manner. Doesn't mean that we, the select board, need to be in charge of the procurement and the contract management.
Okay. So I think the recommendation here is the what? Oh, sorry. One ear out the other.
Morris Root.
Morris Root handle all the contract issues for the town and for the Lake Warners LLC for this project. Okay, is there?
I just want, Mr. Root, could you just explain who you are and what your affiliation is with the project?
Okay.
Professionally, I'm leading you for the first time. Very nice to meet you. Tell us a little bit about you.
Oh, please meet you.
Just for the edification of everybody who's so interested in this project, please.
And okay. People do watch this, so.
Yes.
There's no royalties, though.
No royalties. I'll not give my Bob Hope a Christmas. All right. I do business as Root Engineering. I'm the sole proprietor. I've been doing this business with dams for only 40 years. I've worked, for example, with the Massachusetts Department of Conservation and Recreation, which was formerly the Department of Environmental Management, with a master services agreement on and off since 1994. We talk about procurement process, as I did with Mr. Nixon. Just looking at the statistics as I came in, this would be the ninth project that I've managed where we've had to satisfy the Commonwealth regulations for public procurement.
Did you design the dam?
I did not design the dam, but I have worked on several old dams. It seems to be the niche that I've filled in the engineering marketplace. That I've been around dams long enough so that there's something, even though we can't tear it apart and autopsy the thing, there's an idea of what you might expect, understanding that this is the site of a dam since at least 1690, and it's seen multiple changes in location and upgrades and changes with styles and whatnot. So there's been a fair amount of research into, what's going on and, we're looking at this point in time. I mean, the simple design is that we have quite a bit of concrete restoration to do, and the complication and the challenge is basically to keep Lake Warner in place, pass the water from the Mill River, and do the concrete work simultaneously. But that's, in a nutshell, the intent is to tackle the project.
So you're the engineer and project engineer that's been hired by Kristen and Kestrel Trust to oversee the project?
Correct.
Soup to nuts. Excellent.
This is the notice of intent that was submitted to the Hadley Conservation Commission in December. So we've gone through several hearings with the Hadley Conservation Commission.
Is this our copy or is this one that you're showing me?
I'm showing it to you. I'm happy to leave you one, though, if you'd like one.
No, thank you.
But there is one on record in the town.
That's all I needed. Yeah. Thank you.
So you plan to leave the lake in place while you do the work?
Yes.
Cofferdam?
Yeah, it's going to be staged cofferdamming where we...
Upstream or downstream of the bridge?
Downstream.
Wow, it's tight.
Yes.
What are you going to work off of?
A skyhook.
That's what I was thinking. I just want to say that.
Yeah, no, quite honestly, yes, it's a tight space. And in order to do this, we're essentially looking at what I call a right abutment, which is right next to the Weisbert's apartment house, formerly the Hans General Store, next to the historical monument. We're going to have to clear some trees and basically set up a pad where we'll probably can early on start with working with a medium to heavy excavator, like a Caterpillar 330, 340, you know, with a 30-foot reach and what have you, and sheet pile that area and just essentially work on the concrete on that side of the dam, get that area repaired, and then with a lower cofferdam extend across the river and open up the sluice gate that we'll have refurbished and in operation when we reach across the river. We're going to have to control the height of the cofferdam so that we don't end up flooding the sector's residents should we see any high flows coming down the river. We're taking a look at the hydrology and the hydraulics so that in the end we'll probably be seeing, you know, two major stages in the cofferdam and kind of a sub-phase of the second one to protect the river.
So we wouldn't expect the water level to go down hardly at all?
Correct.
Okay. And would the bridge be open at all times during this, or are you rerouting down French Street?
The expectation is that traffic will be allowed to flow normally most of the time. We may have days when we're mobilizing the crane and setting up, because eventually, as I say, we can start with a medium to heavy excavator in the Caterpillar 330, 340 class, and then may eventually have to move in something like an 80-ton crane, like a Mantis, which has the hydraulic boom where you have the flexibility of working with a shorter stick and then extending it the 80 and 90 feet that you need to literally reach across the river and touch the sector's house. But that's essentially the way we see that we're going about doing it.
Has there been any communication with the neighborhood down there to let them know exactly what's going on? Excellent, great.
No, just spent the afternoon with the Boisferts. They're not boiling this afternoon because of the sap a little bit.
There's a memorandum of understanding with the sectors, the Boys Roads, and Beverly Roads has also agreed to
okay.
staging.
That's what I was just going to ask. All the abutters are satisfied with your operation right now at this point?
Yeah, we've had quite a few meetings with folks in the neighborhood because we've had to plan just about every phase of the contract as far as temporary staging area for the contractor, which is going to be right across the road. Beverly Rose has agreed to use a portion of her meadow. On the other side of the bridge, we have some of the muddy water that we'll be pumping up out of behind the cofferdam needs to be treated before it's returned to the lake. So that'll be up on the Greenbine property, which is just upstream of the bridge. Met with those folks, and they've agreed to that. And so yes, we've had many conversations with the sectors and the voice hurts.
It's great.
So I can keep asking questions out of professional curiosity, but I will get hit by somebody on the board if I do that.
Well, I'll give
can
you my
we
card.
Instantly ask non-professional curiosity questions?
Yes.
Okay. And I'm not sure if this is actually for you or all of you.
I have one too. Go ahead. Maybe on the same page.
No. Well, I'm just in terms of any potential liability.
That depends. It's one of the things that Ms. DeBoer and I were talking about with respect to the contract that's going to be signed with the state money, mm-hmm. Whether that flows through the town or whether that stays entirely with the Kestrel Land Trust. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know the answer to that. Mm-hmm. We're going to work with Representative Sybeck in order to clarify that particular issue, exactly how does the state money flow through.
Okay.
You had some ideas. Certainly.
Who hired him?
Kestrel.
Who hired Morris?
Yeah.
Yes.
So he's your responsibility. And are you paying for him?
He seems like a fine fellow.
He does. I know, but I'm just trying to verify that for people.
So we've raised $374,000. Mm-hmm. Which more than covers the budget, including an endowment, project management, and the design phase. So we've been contracted with Morris through the design phase, and this discussion is about entering the construction phase. And so the Hadley CPA funds that were appropriated through town meeting for $100,000 and Sybeck's appropriation of $125,000 mm-hmm. from the state will combine to pay for the construction phase. Mm-hmm. And so I did go through the CPA grant agreement, which we'd like to get to you for your next select board meeting for signing. I need to wait till the final numbers are in there, but I think that provides a very clear disbursement method for the town's monies, and I think addresses liability in this contract.
So if there's, presuming confidence and it will all go well, but it is tight space and all this other stuff, I mean, it's not necessarily a slam dunk either. So if there was some sort of, you know, failure to perform on the part of Mr. Root, I mean, how, and there are damages that result, you know, during this construction phase, how does that get handled? It's just a weird situation, you know.
So Mr. Root would carry insurance for the situation, and the contractor would be carrying insurance for the situation. We would.
And you're comfortable with the sufficiency of that?
Right, and I would certainly share all of that information, what our insurance requirements are for a project like this.
We don't know that.
No, but I mean, if there's a breach of some kind, that, you know, we just want to make sure there's protection in place along the way.
Yeah, the town could be named additional insured on such insurance certificates.
Can be done.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And if something were to happen to you, not that I'm wishing it, but again, you know, you get sick or hurt, you mentioned that you're a sole proprietor, then work would stop and you would need to find a replacement for Root Engineering?
Well, okay, let me respond to that. You know, I am the sole proprietor. I'm essentially, just put myself in the role of the general contractor.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth of the matter is that I do represent an engineering team.
Okay, all right.
I've been working with a larger engineering firm who's really been supplying the graphical support,
mm-hmm.
A Vermont firm. They have a little bit of an outpost someplace in Massachusetts, maybe.
Du Bois and Keene.
Pardon me?
Stantec.
Well,
geez, I hope not.
Guilford.
Yeah. Meanwhile, no, there's, as you know, working with consultants is highly personal. So with Stantec, yeah, but Stantec is not involved in the design at all. They're doing the weapons science for me. Although I am, my previous employer was the prior firm prior to Stantec. So meanwhile, but I am working with Du Bois and King, which is a larger firm with AD engineers. And actually, the designer, you know, is another structural engineer. So I actually represent a team of 80, 90 people. So in the event I were to disappear, I mean, I could name two other professional engineers that would be right here and ready to step in. So plus, I'm fully insured, so.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so I guess...
One more question. Oh. So then, if you have all the money in place that you need from the donations, state funds, and the CPA donations, why are we coming back for CPA more money for this project?
We're not.
We're not. You're not going to.
That's the Friends of Lake
We're
Warner.
We're not.
Friends of Lake Warner are coming
back Friends
for more
of Lake
money.
Warner. That, I believe, is an entirely different request, separate from the dam repair.
Mm-hmm.
This is just about the repair of the structure.
Great. Is there a motion?
I'd like to hear your question, Mr. Chairman.
Any comments on this also by the public?
I'd like to
hear your professional question.
My professional question?
Yeah.
Oh, I just had a whole bunch of, it's going to be a tight spot.
Yes.
I mean, it'd be well worth videotaping the whole thing. That would be kind of cool.
I'm actually going to buy a webcam, I think.
Yeah, so you can like do the whole thing while you... Maybe you can talk to Richard and we can like have updates on it.
Subscription service or something.
Yeah.
Make a couple bucks.
So is there any other questions from the select board?
Mm-hmm. No.
Okay, a dam cam.
A dam cam.
The dam cam.
Right.
Beaver cam.
Go ahead.
This is a question that's dear to my heart. I live right across the street from this project and I've never been contacted. My neighbors haven't been contacted either. What I want to know is he representing Kistel Trust are the Friends of Lake Warner.
Chris.
Kestrel. So the dam is owned by Lake Warner LLC,
mm-hmm.
Which is owned by Valley Land Fund, and Kestrel Land Trust is owns Valley Land Fund. So there's three nest boxes.
But
Friends
who is he representing?
He is representing Lake Warner LLC on behalf of Kestrel Land Trust.
Okay.
Friends of Lake Warner is a grassroots organization that is forming to look at the health of the pond, and they've also agreed to take the dam once it's fully repaired with an endowment to ensure long-term maintenance. And so we have an agreement that we're working on with them in order to facilitate that transfer once the dam is repaired.
And to your question about not being contacted, I hope that isn't true, that the or that it was some oversight, that the project notice of intent required all abutters to be contacted, so you should have been sent something through that.
He's probably not within the 300.
Maybe it's within 300 feet, I'm probably 350 away.
Okay, well, I'd be happy to
That would answer the question.
Yeah, it's 100 foot, but anyhow.
It's 100 here?
100 foot.
In Hadley?
Okay.
You know, the other thing, years ago, when I was a child, I swam in that lake every night. I ate the fish out of that lake every night. Today, you can't do either. And the town of Amherst paid Echo Science to do a study why the lake become eutrophic. They blamed the Scotts Farm 10 cows for causing it to become eutrophic, when the real answer was the growth of the University of Massachusetts feeding effluent right into Mill River, right into Lake Warner. And that's how they paid for the report, so they got the answer they wanted. But this is what we have today. There's so much liability involved in this dam. I've donated all kinds of money to the Friends, but I'm afraid to join as a member, because if it ends up in their hands, they could be liable for the dam and the town possibly.
I make a motion.
And the motion is?
That we allow this project to continue
under
the direction of Mr. Root. And
Kestrel Land Trust.
And Kestrel Land Trust.
Second, add Lake Warner LLC.
Lake Warner LLC as well. Kestrel
Land. You want anybody else tonight? It's Lake Warner. And there's a second?
I seconded.
Any more discussion from the board?
We left you out, Donald, so you're not liable.
Thank goodness.
The actual notification's in this book if you want to look at it. You are a couple of lots away.
Town's liable too.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good luck.
Yep. Thank you.
It will be kind of, it's going to be a neat full project.
When will it be underway, this year?
Yes. We expect to close the hearing with the Conservation Commission next Tuesday night, and we hope to get the public bid process going by the middle of this month, end of the month, so that we could have a contract award and break ground. Because one of the things with the interwoven state and federal permit process, one thing that we're looking toward is the federally established window by the Corps of Engineers working during what they think is the water season, the 1st of July to the 30th of September. So we're really shooting to break ground and literally be in the water right after the 4th of July holiday.
Good luck.
All right. We entertain questions.
Thanks, Chris.
I don't know if anybody else wants my card, but I'd be quite willing to respond to any questions.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so I'm going to jump to the item 5.3. Well, I want to talk about the schedule, because this is our schedule for interviews for the budget. And we actually did schedule accountant.
Finance committee meetings. Can we decide if we're going to do it? Both the finance committee.
That's what this is.
Is this what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah,
so we have two schedules. One is our schedule to have the departments come talk to us. Mm-hmm. So next meeting, the 9th, we have Public Works, Inspection Services to come talk to us.
Mm-hmm.
The 16th, which is...
No, we're not
going to meeting on the 16th.
Okay, so we have to reschedule the accountant and the select board.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, the 23rd will be Park and Rec, Library, Council on Aging, Planning Board, Conservation, and Hadley Public Access TV. April 6th, Assessor, Treasurer, Collector, Clerk, Health, Appeals, Veteran Services, and Historical Commission on the 6th. And then the 13th is our catch-up day. So are we okay with that schedule, skipping the 16th?
Can I ask, why are we separating the accountant and the, normally don't we have the treasurer and the accountant in together?
Do we?
We do because of there's some shared.
Yeah, there's some shared things.
Line items and things like that?
Yeah.
Well, it'd be good to do it now, because we're moving up to the 16th.
I think the only reason why I split them up is because I tried to pair these people up with the finance committee meeting the following Saturday for each of those appointments, and so I tried to give people a budget week rather than have budgets spread out over a larger period of time. So I can move accountant down to the treasurer, that's not going to be a problem.
Okay.
And I can move the select board up to the 9th.
This is just feeling uncomfortably late to me.
Sounds early to me.
Caesar.
Compared to last.
No, that's not true. I mean,
do you want to put more in, move them up? We decide not to meet the 16th.
Well, I mean, I'm just flash forwarding to April. So April 6th, we're still, I mean,
we can
large
do the 16th. That's no biggie.
Because then we're really just, I mean, I don't think that on, you know, if we followed the schedule that on April 13th, that we'll be sitting here going, oh, this is easy. We're a balance. I think there's going to be some gnashing of teeth, and we need to allow for
gnashing of teeth.
Dental repair,
right.
Yeah.
In the month of April.
Let's do some for the 16th.
Then. Okay, so then we want to move more to the 16th.
Can you do the 16th?
Sure, I can do the 16th.
Okay. Well, should we move the treasurer and
is there any need to bring the planning board in, the historical commission in, or any of those? If they're level funded at this point in time, I mean, is there any real significance that needs to draw them in?
The planning board is not level funded. They asked for an increase in their stipend, which I recommend against, and so I think we've, out of respect to them, they should have an opportunity to defend their their request.
And I know the Board of Health indicated to me that they wanted to have some budget-related conversation. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is yet, but
okay.
They make more than we do.
I mean, there's actually one more meeting. There's one more Wednesday in March too that we don't have on here.
What's that?
Oh, the 30th. March 30th is not here.
5 weeks.
So if we want to do them all in March, so that we're done in the March.
What would a Wednesday night be without a meeting?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just so you know, I'm actually going to be out of town on March. Wait. No, scratch that. That's the end of April. Never mind.
Yeah, during
spring
break.
I can't remember which one. No, actually, for work. I'm going to travel.
Yeah, we could do some for the 30th, too.
So it's up to.
Let's get it done.
Yeah. Get it done.
All right, so let's rearrange these, push things up, some up to the 16th.
Just make out a schedule
and then
and give it to us.
Okay. Move the 6th to the 30th.
Yep, so it looks like the treasurer, so the financial ones we should move to the 16th,
mm-hmm.
Treasurer and stuff, and then the planning board. Oh, planning board's on there for the 23rd.
Let's just send it, make a schedule and send it to us.
Yep.
Okay.
We'll be here.
Okay.
So we're going to do 9th, 16th, 23rd, and 30th.
Right.
Okay.
The side's quiet on my left.
Yeah. Let's get it.
We're in agreement. That's what we want to do for the schedule.
Okay. Mm-hmm. You've got too many numbers and not enough of time.
All right. So last time I closed this document, I lost my board docs.
I learned it's up here.
Yeah.
I know, but
go to the top.
I did. Okay. I kept it that time. Okay.
We're all learning.
So. Let's go review and revision of the annual town meeting warrant. I didn't want to do a lot of detailed discussion. If there's some we think we can just push out of the way because there are recurring articles that we can agree to and be done with, that's fine.
You mean for purposes of just taking a vote and
yes.
Being done with it? Yeah.
So the first three articles are the standard articles for applying for grants, Chapter 90 and short-term borrowing authorization. Finance Committee has already recommended those three.
Okay, do we want to recommend those as well?
I will make a motion that we recommend those.
Second.
Okay. Discussion? So 1, 2, and 3 would probably be on the consent agenda as well?
Yeah. I'd assume so.
I talked to the moderator about that, so that looks like it's going to happen.
All right. So is it...
This is consent agenda, too.
Let me get that.
Yeah, there's another one.
So there's a motion for 1, 2, and 3. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Article 4 is
yes.
Your revolving funds. The only changes there are the removal of the North Hadley Village Hall rental because we're going to be selling that.
So moved. You're going to put it on the key.
Well, so motion, second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And we want to try to put down on the consent agenda?
We can do it. So we often get questions on this, so.
That's fine. They can take it. I mean, they can always move to take it off.
Yeah.
Article 5 is a one-off article. It's more housekeeping than anything. The University of Massachusetts partnership agreement included a $14,000 donation to the town of Hadley so we can buy a message board. That board has been procured, and now we need to funnel the funds in such a way as to make it accessible. So in consultation with the accountant, we're asking to set up for this current fiscal year, FY16, a revolving fund for $14,000 so that we can process that payment through the University of Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
So didn't we just authorize grants and gifts, or
yes.
just grants?
How is this different?
Yeah.
It's just the way that the money is handled. It's not technically a grant. It's a transfer of money between the Commonwealth and political subdivision.
Why does that need to be accepted on town meeting floor?
Because we can't pay for it otherwise.
Yeah. This is to actually make payment for the board, right?
Yeah.
I mean, to set it up so that we can pay the board.
Yeah, it's their grant that they wrote for it. It was a grant, correct? That's what they said it was.
It's a gift.
It's a gift from the university.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we determine it's not a gift in the true sense of gifts and grants we've approved
right.
to receive and expend. It's a special gift we have to have a special place to put.
Okay.
Right.
Because UMass is special.
This is just housekeeping. It has no impact upon your budget.
So I'm going to make a special motion that we approve that.
A special motion.
Is there a special second?
There is.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Especially.
So we probably have to leave that off the consent.
Yeah, I think that has to be second.
Okay.
All right.
Article 6 is for the retro pay for the contracts for the union.
So
I have filled in numbers, which I'm going to pass out. And I think you should take that under advisement.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
7 is...
7 is required for the enterprise fund that we have to set up for the Hadley Public Access TV because of the rule change at the state government level having to do with how we appropriate cable TV franchise funds. So this is a two-part article. Article 7 sets up the authorization for an enterprise fund. And transfers the money that's currently in the Hadley Public Access Cable account over to the Enterprise Fund, and then the appropriation will be handled under the omnibus budget in Article 8.
Okay. Do we want to take a position on this now?
Has this been through legal review yet, the language?
No, this
so I hear no resounding vote on this now. We're going to skip this one.
Skip it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is there any other ones we want to talk about now?
Article 9 is a recurring amount. Mm-hmm. Article, this is to set aside money for the replacement of the membranes at the water treatment plant. This is the 9th year that we've done this. The money has been upped to $20,000 from $10,000.
Yeah.
Comes from water reserves. This is almost always put on the consent agenda.
But why did it go from 10 to 20?
Because the costs have escalated since this originally was put together 9 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So factoring in inflation, we're going to increase the amount that we're setting aside.
Okay. And this is the first year we're doing it at 20?
That's right, but the ninth year that we've been setting money aside. It's about $81,000 in that account now.
At what point in time will this be started spend down?
The membranes are in very good shape right now, but they do have a life expectancy of 10 years. So we could be making an appropriation to replace some or all of these membranes as early as 2018, but they seem to be in good shape, so I say continue putting money aside for the replacement.
Well, if we have $81,000 there now, we have no actual setup at this point in time to make any replacements. When you replace the membranes, are they replaced all of them at once, or is it a phased-in system?
We have three trains, so it depends. Probably you have to replace the entire
train at a time
when it occurs, but are they all going to fail at the same time? Probably not.
Yeah, you'd actually, side note, I would start replacing at 10 years, the oldest, worst-looking ones, regardless if they're
before it fails.
Ready, yeah. And then you start staggering them out.
So then you replace one. One every 5 years or something.
So we would probably replace one train in 10 years just to get that stagger going, I would think.
Right.
So
these trains were all made at the same time, so mm-hmm. they're all at the same age.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Any reason to get our new DPW director's input on this before we vote?
We could.
I mean, it's a bit of a housekeeping, but on the other hand, I'd like to hear what he has to say.
You might not know.
Then he'll find out. He'll put it on his
list.
We can talk about it when the Briggs comes in with the budget.
Yeah.
All right, we'll leave it alone.
Good.
So 10 is not ready for us to vote on. 11's ready for us if we want to.
This is $261,000 for the water line replacement through the SRF program. We're still working all the paperwork associated with this. So
it's not ready?
Why do I think that was $211,000?
I gave you a number of $217,210, and then we added a 20% contingency and rounded it up.
Okay,
so 12 we're not ready to vote on either. 13 through 17 aren't ready. 18 is not.
It's not ready.
19 is not ready either.
No.
And 20 and 21 aren't ready. 22.
I think we're kind of done.
22, I recommend that you adopt this. We're going to have to enter into an agreement, which you're going to, we're currently negotiating. But there's no reason not to prepare this article for town meeting. This would be for a solar pilot agreement for the solar installation over at the University of Massachusetts. They're estimating, let me get the information, they're estimating uh, 2.179 megawatts of direct current, which would translate into approximately $21,790 for new growth for the town of Hadley.
Where's that going?
That would go under new growth.
I'm sorry, where physically is that going?
That's physically going on the Champion Center, the parking lot north of Mullins Center, and the PBTA roof. And there's other installations in Amherst that they're putting in. I've just listed the Hadley ones.
And the reason we have a pilot here is because they're actually going out for power purchase agreements with a third-party supplier.
Right.
But do we need to approve that tonight, or?
It's a housekeeping. If you don't approve the contract, then we're going to skip over the
article
pilot agreement here.
All right, I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
So 2023, Mr. Devine, you want to talk a little bit about it?
Well, I just said that we take a look at dropping the quorum from 100 people at town meeting to 50.
So, do we want to take a position on that, or we want to talk a little more about that?
Moved.
Dropping it from 100 to 50?
Yeah. You know, most municipalities in Massachusetts have zero. I mean, one.
I kind of like the one personally.
It's a real democracy.
I think we might want to have some discussion about that.
I'm absolutely against it.
Okay, we'll talk more about it. We won't vote.
Yep.
Okay.
So then we have the article to request the select board make the...
Gooseberry?
No, that we move the day to Saturday versus Thursday. So that's probably something we want to talk more about. We're not ready for that. Then we need to do acceptance of gooseberry.
This I've transferred this over to the planning board,
right.
So I'd wait for the recommendation.
And then we have a bunch of CPA things which we're really not ready for.
The school committee has a CPA article that they're preparing and that's not on the agenda. So I recommend that we open the warrant, accept their article for CPA, and close the warrant again. CPA committee is meeting on March 7th.
Okay. And then we have two planning board articles and then one petition article on zoning. Mm-hmm. So do we want to take no position on those because they're zoning and planning board articles, or are we going to take a position this year?
Just a personal one.
Do we have any personal opinions on the last article?
Not yet.
So is that how we want to handle the planning board and the citizen petition, that we don't want to take a position on those? Or we don't?
I have a feeling, I mean, just particularly with the petition article, there's going to be an awful lot of dialogue on town meeting floor. And I really do like to hear the wider input.
So, I mean, we can officially take no position.
Yeah, we can We can talk about that later.
Okay, so we're going to talk about those later. Yeah. Okay, so we've run through. We have 31 articles and actually going to be 32 articles.
Are you going to open up the warrant to accept that one article?
Do they actually have it finished?
We have conceptual language.
Which article is that?
This would be for the school committee to develop recreational land.
The ball fields. This is about the ball fields. They're looking for some CPA money, $435,000. We met with them the other day with the capital planning and Edwin Matusko and them, and they're looking at $435,000 to develop the land or phase one of the land that was swapped.
So is there a motion to open the warrant to put the article in? Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So close the warrant.
Make a motion to close the warrant.
Second.
Do we have to accept the article?
Oh, yeah, you do.
Is there a motion to accept the article?
So moved.
Second.
Second?
Yeah.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Do I have a motion to close the warrant?
So moved.
They were just looking for a placeholder on that. They haven't brought forward an article for us to accept or not to accept.
We just put it in there.
Yes.
We have the placeholder. Don't accept the article. I mean.
No, we're accepting the
Jerry, so I think the one, concept. Is that the way you understood it, Jerry? They have a design phase and an A and a B development phase?
This is phase one of the, it's $1,000,003 for the both.
Yeah.
This is $435,000.
Is there a motion to close the warrant?
Same story.
Is there a second?
Yeah.
Second.
All those in favor to close the warrant?
Aye.
All right, so we went to 32 articles. Right. So
I don't have 32 there on my sheet.
We just added 32.
I'm at 26.
No,
go up. That's 30. Go up. You're on.
Oh,
right.
Okay.
Sorry,
so
you're at 31 or 2.
Okay. So the thing we need to be thinking about is how, if we want to, we'll probably have to review the warrants for the rest of the ones we haven't talked about. And so if you have a preference of something you want to talk about during a meeting, let me know and we'll specifically put it on the agenda that we're going to talk about this item. And that way everybody knows we're going to talk about that item.
Is this Article 28, is this the $9,600 from Community Preservation Act Fund for Lake Warner monitoring? Is that what you were talking about, Donald? You don't know.
That was what Joyce was talking about.
Oh, that was?
Yes.
Okay. But that's, that committee will come in and speak on that, or?
They probably won't. They'll just put it on that warrant article, and CPA will speak to it on town meeting floor.
Yeah, then we need to decide whether if we take no position on the CPA articles, it's probably the best approach. CPA is truly up to, once it's approved that it's a valid project for CPA, it's truly up to the voters to say yay or nay.
Yeah.
And that varies from every other warrant article and how
Well, we get to have a, we have a little more say than the other ones.
I see.
Okay, so technology plan. We have an update for the technology plan.
So, review the technology plan. There are some priority recommendations for Town Hall in particular that will help increase productivity. I have left over from the capital article for IT $9,000, which should address those immediate concerns for Town Hall. So permission to go out and start spending money according to the recommendations of the IT plan for Town Hall, for the routers, for the firewall, and for some of the wiring. And then the other recommendations I'm digesting and including in the update to the capital plan, so we'll be incorporating that into the larger plan for the town that we'll be developing over the summer in preparation for the fall town meeting capital articles.
So
I thought we were going to invite the consultant here for this.
Right. We need to bring them in and have them give a report, but I think we can just start taking some action right away on this.
Yeah.
Is there any in that town hall monies available to expand the board docs already on a few issues that we've brought up so far?
Can I just, I'll be honest with you, going through this report,
yeah,
there's some issues that are so immediate,
yeah,
that personally I think the board docs, I would like to see those changes made.
Yeah.
I agree with you, John, but I think that the money is best deployed
okay
immediately.
Mm-hmm.
But just, you know, one of the things that's threaded throughout this report, we're kind of in this interesting situation because, to the consultant pointed out, you know, we're going to be moving logically at some point over the coming years. There are going to be some shifts in buildings, but there are also some things that beg for immediate correction, like switches and things like that, that will provide our employees with immediate improvement, and certainly I think that those should be acted upon. But by the same token, I didn't walk away from this report feeling extremely confident in the current resources that we're utilizing for IT. And I just worry that if we forge ahead, as much as I want to and think we should, with these equipment changes, who's going to be putting them in? Who's doing the oversight? I mean, are we going to utilize Northeast IT to help with that? Thank you. Okay, I feel better now.
Okay, so the only thing I would ask for is we actually get a list of what we're going to be able to fit into the 9,000, so we just know and we can
right.
show that to people.
And what the point is. I think it's really important to say we're upgrading this switch and here is the outcome that you can expect.
So, and then, so have we talked to, like, Northeast IT to come in and when they want to do the proposal, when they want to present this?
I've sent them an email asking them to select a time. I wanted to find out what your budget schedule was going to be. I would like to do this in a time when we're not trying to solve all the problems of the FY15-17 budget. Mm-hmm.
Well,
so sometime in April, does that work for folks?
Well,
yeah,
part of this is should be in the capital plan.
Yeah.
Right.
So we mm-hmm. do need to know this sooner than later for the cap. I mean, there's things we might want to slide into the capital that we need to know for the budget process.
Well, and there's some line items that affect, or there's some suggestions in here that have a direct impact on some of the line items in departmental
yeah.
budgets, like fire in particular. I'm just wondering if the department heads don't have this, do they?
No, I should send it
sooner
right.
is
right.
better, I say.
Yeah.
Okay.
So let's try to...
I mean, particularly Mike Spanknebel and Mike Mason need to hone in on it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm concerned that Mike Spanknebel, some of the line items may or may not be impacted. Park and Rec actually stuck out a bit here. I don't think that that's an immediate issue. But, for example, if one of the suggestions is we have a one-off department that has max, and we should move away from that and go... you know, standardize on the equipment that we're using. I don't know the
max.
Park and Rec.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but I mean, I don't want to see
wow.
anything in their budget that's doing anything to enhance what they have if we're going to be getting rid of it. And, you know, I mean, so it's that kind of thing. I just think it's important to get it out to them.
Usually it's the IT department that has max and everybody else has.
No.
Okay, so we, sooner is better than later.
Got it.
All right. So any more discussion about the IT plan for now? Our last item of business tonight is we need to do a contract extension for the master plan with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission.
So they've extended, they're supposed to finish their project towards the end of March. They're stating that they need additional time. They've asked for an extension that could be as late as December 31st. As late as December 31st. I sent this over to the Planning Department Board for their comment and review. They unanimously recommend the change order.
Really?
Is there a rough draft that's available?
I have some information downstairs that I can share with you about the community survey.
Could we ask for a comment from the Planning Board? I mean, I know that they approved it, and I caught part of the meeting, but not the whole meeting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I caught this conversation out of context.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they'll send us their minutes.
So
yeah, or even yeah, or a memo
we'll
from Bill or whatever.
Okay.
Yeah, we got till March 31st on it anyways.
Mm-hmm. My understanding was this is a small extension. They're asking for the rest of the year.
3/4 of a year.
Yep.
So this
a
is
long extension.
So this is the second thing they've done for us in recent time mm-hmm. that has gone beyond the time period they said they would take. The historical restrictions for North Hadley Hall, and now this. Is there, we need to...
Well, I mean, you know, the Planning Board was in charge of this project. If it's their recommendation, I certainly support it. You know, I don't understand why it's taking too long, but I can ask them, and it should be available part of their minutes.
Yeah, and that's my only point, Jerry. I have, like, a better understanding of why. I mean, because the memo doesn't really
explain
it as well as maybe it should from the PVPC, not our Planning Board.
So I guess we need to put this on another agenda to talk about some more and get some more information with this.
Okay.
And PVPC needs to really know that's kind of, we do a lot with them.
Well, it sounds like they've got some staffing issues.
We all do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I'm just saying.
Okay. So, I think that's it for tonight. We have announcements?
We got a couple. The select board would like to send their condolences to Michael Squiz on the passing of his father, Roger, and also to the Kornuski family for the passing of Erna. I didn't know Roger, but I did know Erna. She was a delightful, hardworking lady, and I know she will surely be missed by the community in North Hadley, where she worked for several people and her family, so condolences to them.
Do we have any other announcements?
Thoughts and prayers to the Lorenza family. Pete's been in the hospital the last couple days, and he's doing a lot better, I heard, in the last day or two than he was, but thinking about you, Pete.
Do we have a champion cornhole team?
We do, and it was an outstanding contest. I do not know the top two teams. I do not know. Mm-hmm. Third place went to Johnny and Patty Hayes, but they were not, I don't want to say local because that doesn't make sense, but I mean they were teams that I was not familiar with. It was an outstanding tournament, though, and had a lot of people work really hard. Tom Washkevitz and a lot of other people, and it was a fabulous event.
Excellent.
Great. 32 teams. They were done at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and some of the teams were done in 7 minutes. They were...
That quick?
Pretty. They're real cornholers, and they paid a lot of attention to it. Other teams were there for simply to have a lot of fun, and they did that as well. Mugs
it was
Club.
A great event. I attended. And luckily, I bought $20 worth of raffle tickets, and I won a one-man fishing kayak.
Oh, nice. Congratulations.
So it was worth going.
Yeah. Go in the pond.
And I do have one congratulations.
Okay.
I'd like to congratulate the voters in the town of Hadley. Outstanding turnout this week on Super Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And you're on a roll, and let's see everybody show up in April. Same numbers. Was it close to 50%?
Something like that.
54,
close to 50%.
That'd be great.
We even beat our neighbors next door.
We did. For sure. Pretty excited.
Yeah. All right. Anything else? Motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.